In this video lecture, we'll show how to add methods to a class which will allow objects of that class to display themselves in some program. Okay, let's get started. All right, let's take stock of where we're at so far in building our person class. So far, we've seen how to add an instance variable and how to add a couple of constructors so that now we can create new objects of the person class type. Now we need some way of seeing into any objects that we've created. As you've no doubt seen already in prior lecture materials, one way to do this would be through the use of the debugger. After all, on the left side, the debugger displays all variables and objects as they're created. And so for person objects, we could click to expand them and see all their internal instance variables. Well, this is okay for us as developers of code, but users of our code, who would be in the vast majority, wouldn't be using an IDE. So now what do we do? A better way would be to be able to see the contents of our objects programmatically and have it displayed to the screen. So to address the next part of our person API, we're going to show how to implement two specific display methods, toString and print. Hopefully you remember these from using the CS12Date class because they were part of its API also. toString is a standard method that every class in Java provides for. It has a very standard interface, and it simply returns a string representation of any object in some designer's choice format. If you think about CS12Date, at its core are three ints for month, day, and year, and so its toString method simply returns a string that gathers those up into traditional month/day/year format. I believe you had a program exercise in which you created an alternate dashes format of the same data. Same idea. Print is an alternate non-standard method which we'll use in this course, and you probably recall this one also from using CS12Date. Rather than returning a string to any caller, this one instead prints some multi-line output with one label and one piece of data on each line in a nice readable format. I found this to be extremely helpful during code development, so I added it to CS12Date, and we'll also implement it for our person class. Here's what the toString method looks like internally. Its purpose is to return some string representation of an object's data to the calling client. The interface shown here is standard for any Java class. It has a public access specifier, because obviously we want outside clients to be able to use this. It returns some string to the caller, and it requires no input arguments. The return format is completely at the designer's discretion. Maybe it's a list of comma-separated values, maybe space-separated values, or anything else that seems useful. For our purposes with a person class, we're simply going to string concatenate all the instance variables into a comma-separated list and return that string to the caller. Here, because we only have the one instance variable at this point, we can't see that yet. But you'll see that it will be very easy to add additional instance variables once we have this basic structure in place for one instance variable. It's considered a good coding practice to always provide your own class-specific version of this method. And so in this course, we'll consider it a coding standard to always provide your own version of a toString method. Java actually provides a default plain vanilla version of toString if you don't provide your own, but usually this isn't what you want. Implementing your own replacement version of toString like this represents overriding a method in object-oriented programming, or masking a default version with your own version. We'll get back to this idea in a moment. And here's what the print method looks like internally. Again, this one is non-standard, but I find this to be very useful, and we're going to consider always providing this method as another coding standard for this course. In this top print method, we're not returning any value to the caller. So its return type is void, and this version also has no inputs. All we're doing here is printing to the screen a label and a value for our one instance variable in some nice tabbed or readable format. This should look no different from printing any old variable, which you've seen and done countless times by now. All we've done here is wrap a nice, neat method around it. Then this bottom version of print is another example of overloading, or providing an alternative version. Here, we add this one string input variable, and then internally we turn around and print it inside another nice little bounding box, followed by this call to the default version. So this overloaded version is going to print this labeled header, followed by the other print of all the instance variables. Again, right now we are only implementing this for our one current instance variable, But I think you can see how easy it will be to extend the starting pattern to the other instance variables. All we need to do in this top version is simply add one more print statement for each other instance variable. And this overloaded version wouldn't even have to change at all. Pretty nice and easy to scale up. Please take a moment now to pause and view the demo video for personPhase4.java, where we'll demonstrate adding these display methods to our current person class. Come back to this video when you are finished. In the last two slides, we talked in passing about two important object-oriented programming concepts, overloading and overriding. These are often confused with each other, so let's take a few moments to more clearly make the distinction between these. Overloading a method simply means to provide alternate ways of calling that method. Each overloaded method version must have some differing method interface, which must differ in one or more of the following: the number of input arguments, the order of the input arguments, and the data types of the input arguments. Also, recall that simply changing the name of one of the arguments is not sufficient to make things different. The first example we saw of overloading was when we provided multiple constructors for our person class. We said that in this course it would be our coding convention to always provide at least a default constructor, which takes no inputs, and a full constructor, which takes all instance variables as its inputs. We provide multiple ways of creating a new person object to give users options: a quick and easy way, and a full control way. The other example we saw of overloading was in providing two versions of the print method, the second of which internally nests the first version. As we see in this example, we might implement a first version which simply prints all instance variables as a label data pair and takes no inputs. Then if we wanted to embellish that a bit, we might also overload it as shown here, providing an alternate version which accepts some label string, prints it, and then internally calls the other version. By the way, notice that this overloaded version does not repeat any of the printing done by this simpler version, and therefore we're not needlessly duplicating any print code here, which makes these easier to maintain and adapt. As a general coding principle, try not to repeat any code in more than one place if you can avoid it. Then to use this second overloaded version, we simply call it with some desired header text, as shown in this bottom example. Overriding a method is a different idea. It means that we replace or supersede some inherited default version of a method with our own version. In the example we saw of this was toString. It turns out that there's a Java class called Object, which is the ultimate root ancestor of every Java class there is, or every Java class will ever write. The Object class provides a starter toString method that every descendant class inherits, unless we choose to override it with some class-specific version of our own making. It's considered a good software development practice to always override toString with our own version. For example, for our person class, here on the left is the output of the default toString. This is the output generated by the object class. As you can see, it incorporates the name of our person class along with some memory address type data, and frankly, isn't terribly useful. By contrast, on the right is the output of our overridden toString method, which is going to display the instance variables specific to our person class in a comma-separated format. Now this is useful and pertinent to what we're doing. By the way, both of these look like output from executing the person class in some way. So how did we do this? Well, that will now be the subject of our next topic.